And you're watching our program, India at IT Revolution. Today we will tell you future of ICT in India. In the age of digitalization, we cannot imagine our lives without information and communication technologies. But the question remains, what lies in future?
When one projects the future of India, one cannot imagine it without information and communication technologies, or ICT. ICT is a vast term that spans satellites in orbit to mobile phones in the palm of our hands and everything in between. When computers and digital systems first began appearing in India, it was supposed that ICT tools are only meant for the elite and the economically privileged. But in the last decade, that perception has changed drastically as more and more high-tech tools are being used to serve the Indian public, especially the most disadvantaged or underreached.
One thing to actually automate office processes and give reports to a system largely focused on efficiency and effectiveness and productivity, but it's a totally game-changing potential when it comes to really using technology to deliver better service and better customer delivery. Saw a plethora of pilots springing up across the country. Some of them were very successful, you know, things like Bhumi and all made a lot of, you know, or Gyandut in MP.
From education to banking, from healthcare to mass media, weather prediction and food distribution to the poorest of the poor, ICT is accelerating progress. This shifting perspective has had a profound impact on how governments at various levels perform their functions.
Most departments and ministries realize the power of technology and want to deploy it and use it as much as possible. Initially, like I said, they would want to do it for one particular process or one particular activity. Now they want to do it for all processes and all services and all everything that they do.
The all-pervasive nature of ICT is now giving us a glimpse of what India might one day look like if its tools reach every citizen. Perhaps most profoundly, in healthcare, ICT facilitates patient-doctor interaction. It helps manage big hospital systems and regulates operations automatically. ICT has also revolutionized healthcare by reaching smaller and remote areas of India. But what if, in the future, ICT could be used for something even more personal? Thanks to supercomputers, we may one day have this scenario.
Patient goes to a doctor, the patient will be carrying his or her genomic structure onto the smart card. And when the patient visits the doctor or a clinic, the doctor, what he or she will first do is actually put that smart card on a smart card reader and understand the genomic structure of the individual who has come for cure. And then basically based on the genomic structure, the doctor will prescribe customized medicine to that patient.
Not only will this era of personalized medicine be good for the patient, but also for medical research, because there will be a database of millions of virtual humans that could help scientists understand disease without conducting experiments on actual people.
After a lot of simulation, okay, we will have thousands or millions of these virtual humans on the supercomputer. And with the testing that happens with these medicines, we will be actually coming out with exact type of customized medicines that can, in the future, actually be practiced by the doctors.
For diseases like cancer, supercomputing and ICT could bring about a new era in finding a treatment. But that's not where the technology stops. Agriculture is another field that is critical to Indian life. ICT is slowly but surely bringing change here too. Whether it's real-time updates on market prices or the weather. But in the future, it can bring about more exciting changes to impact livelihoods.
We have been kind of working along with the Indian Agricultural Research Institute to look at how the plant genomes can be kind of analyzed and make the plants more disease resistant, etc., high yielding crops, etc. The same way we can also look at livestock basically. When we talk about livestock, we look at poultry, we look at various farm animals which are there. So we have been working along with a number of industries and institutes all over the world where we can kind of look at very seriously genomes of various poultry animals, various livestock animals to increase the yields, high yielding varieties, and also looking at high disease resistance varieties as well basically.
While big science is enabled by computing technologies, ICT connects these worlds and creates a virtual lab where collaboration can happen effortlessly. In India, this new era of collaboration is being brought about networks like the National Knowledge Network. These kind of pan-Indian high-speed networks can have a significant impact on education in the future, as more and more students turn to the internet to supplement their knowledge bank through online courses and tutorials that don't just have text, but also high-resolution audio-visual files.
So when you look at that, if you have a small network, you will not be able to download that particular video file. Whereas if you have a huge bandwidth, you will be able to immediately look at it. So but today, we have the facility or the bandwidth that allows you to download at a much faster pace.
Imagine a time when Indian networks like NKN reach every Indian student. That may happen sooner rather than later, as the NKN has plans to grow in the future.
And that's connected with a scalable network. So today it is 10 gig, so it's going to be 100 gig very soon. So you will see that a common network backbone is there. So this backbone now can be used by all the communities. So what we have done is we have got virtual classrooms, 66 of them in different IITs and NITs and IIC. They all open up their labs, they open up their virtual classroom so that this lecture can be heard by all the people sitting across.
Even as India builds its information networks, the biggest hurdle for most Indians remains digital literacy. Most Indians are still disconnected from computing technologies, but slowly, this gap is being bridged. The mobile phone has brought ICT into the palms of the common man, and it has become one of the most affordable computing devices in the market. And there have been many programs to bring digital literacy to Indians. Some of the most empowering examples of this can be found in India's villages and rural centers, where disadvantaged groups are finding a voice through simple technologies like mobile phones and digital cameras.
पानी की बहुत गंभीर समस्या है। हमारे गांव में कुल 50 घर की बस्ती है, जिसमें मात्र एक ही हैंडपंप है।
In the future, such initiatives will mean that more and more voices are heard. Even if mainstream media does not reach every Indian, they will have the chance to have their voice reach out using easily available devices, social media, and the internet. Perhaps the most potent tool of enhancing digital literacy in India would be to make technologies in Indian languages so that even those who can't communicate in English can use ICT. This is where AI or artificial intelligence comes in. What is artificial intelligence? Simply put, when a computer system or machine can perform the same jobs as human brain can, it is termed as artificial intelligence. Especially when it comes to cognitive tasks involving learning and problem solving. In the 1940s, Alan Turing devised a test to determine whether a computer system can think like a human being. Turing called the test the imitation game. In it, there are two terminals, one manned by a computer, the other by a human. Both terminals are on the same side of a barrier. On its other side is a judge who cannot see them. A series of questions are lobbed to the terminals. Their responses are judged by the judge, who must guess whether they come from the computer or the human. If the judge mistakes the computer for human more than 50% of the time, The computer is said to have artificial intelligence. But what has AI got to do with empowering Indians? AI allows us to bridge barriers of language and human resources to create inclusive ICT. Technologies like speech to text and text to speech ensure that even unlettered Indians can have the benefit of ICT. And in the future, it may be that speech-to-speech technologies prove to be a game-changer.
लेकिन जवाहरलाल घबराए नहीं, अपने देशवासियों और अन्य देशों को समझाते रहे।
I think you can see a scenario wherein if a farmer wants some information, now he has to go to a kiosk, okay? And when he queries there in his own language, the information may not be available in his own language. May be available in English only. It goes, searches the web, extracts the information. After extracting the information, it communicates back to you in your own language.
Once digital literacy and tools reach the people, what would things like food security be like in the future? In some parts of India, a new experiment is empowering the public distribution system. It's called Direct Benefit Transfer or DBT.
DBT is the direct benefit, like the subsidy which is entitled by the beneficiary, the ration card owner. It will be directly pushed to the bank account.
Public services might look very different in future. It will be a whole new world. What it will be, we will tell you after a short break. Welcome back after the break. ICT will be bringing new cultural norms, new way of communicating, and new way of experiencing government.
DBT gives the consumer power to choose what he or she would like to purchase for their family. They are not dependent on specifically allocated commodities from a fair price shop. So, if they don't wish to purchase wheat, they can get more rice, or they can use the funds to buy fruit or eggs or any other food item.
Every user has some logins, every state person's official food and supply officials have login. Food and supply officer login, then just make payment file and upload from here. In upload payment file, the all complete information of that members, which account has been subsidized, like member ID, PFMS beneficiary code, this code is provided by department, also ration card type, beneficiary name, how much amount to be subsidized for wheat commodity, how much amount to be subsidized for rice commodity, for total subsidized amount, and UID or a bank details which is provided.
As of now, the direct benefit transfer facility is being tested in Chandigarh, Puducherry, and Dadar and Nagar Haveli.
They are very happy with the saying that few hiccups were there during the starting period, few reluctance were there what they will do it. Now they feel that like the entire, without any pilferages, without anybody's intervention, they need not take an off day leave or 1 hour permission and go and stand in a queue and get the commodity. That account, it goes, SMS goes, a fund goes to their respective account, and they, at their will and wish, at their own leisure, at their own time, in the evening, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, they can go and procure the grains. That, so it gives a total liberty to them.
Depending on the results of the pilot program, DBT may soon become an efficient way to ensure that every Indian's right to food is fulfilled, all thanks to the power of ICT. Like food security, there are other public services that might look very different in the future. Imagine a world where all your important documents like ration card, passport, driver's license, or PAN card aren't just hard copies that you could lose or damage. Now, thanks to facilities like Digital Locker, it could be real. This is a unique government-based ICT service that allows any user with a UIDAI number to start an account and upload key documents. It offers a dedicated personal space of 10 MB where you can store documents securely. It also allows easy sharing of these files with concerned authorities. Currently, it is in beta phase, but in the near future, Digital locker may lead to a new era of paperless governance. After the break, we'll see how ICT is going to bring weather prediction to our fingertips. The vagaries of weather and climate have always impacted progress and development.
The quake hit at 4:35 a.m.
India recently recorded its highest ever temperature, mercury in one town shooting up to 51 degrees Celsius.
For India's economic and social health, understanding phenomena like monsoon, cyclones and heat waves is critical. Today, weather prediction is a sophisticated science, employing the latest tools of technology. It's common to receive weather updates on the television and even on mobile phones. But how could weather forecasts become even more personalized in the future? Every day, observation systems like satellites, radars, and other instruments generate a massive amount of weather-related data. It's studied by forecasters at the Indian Meteorological Department, or IMD. IMD uses this data in an indigenously developed software tool called RAPID, which is easily accessible through the internet. RAPID custom designs satellite images to answer a wide variety of user questions. It's a more comprehensive resource than the grayscale image derived from the satellite.
In the image, we only having a fixed state boundaries and district boundary map. Here we can put any type of map, open street map, Bhuvan map, means airport location, railway location, highway location, all these things can be put as if in the background of the image.
Instead of relying on generic forecasts, RAPID allows the user to get personalized answers to their specific queries.
This will be useful. Suppose during winter season, we have a lot of fog during day and night, and it affects the railway movement. If railway people will use this facility or utility, they can see up to what extent fog is present, so they can manage the traffic in a better way.
As sensors aboard satellites have become more sophisticated, the data we receive on Earth has also improved. RAPID can now help forecasters with more detailed information.
This is grey and white images were available in the earlier fashion. No color images were there. Now we start generating the different spectral band combination images. Red, green, blue. Means each spectrum band is assigned one type of color. The combination of color help us to identify the type of cloud or different type of weather. So this can be seen here in the RAPID. If you see this type of color, this is showing snow. This portion is a fog. This is a fog. And if we just change the location, this is a cloud which can give rain.
RAPID is also extremely useful in times of natural disasters or extreme weather phenomena like cyclones or floods.
Suppose this is imager is there and this full disk image is there on that. And you want to measure the area of affected in the kilometer square. This can be feasible also. Suppose this cloud is there. Up to what extent and how much area is covered by this cloud? We can see it. Depend user requirement. How user want to use it? That is the user friendly manner. This is the best use of digital India.
Nowadays, public establishments are reshaping themselves to perform their duties according to actual circumstances. But how? We will tell you after a short break.
The Kishore Vaigyanik Protsahan Yojana Fellowships provides students with a monthly stipend of Rs. 5,000 during their undergraduation and Rs. 7,000 during their post-graduation. Along with the monthly fellowship, they are also entitled to receive a contingency grant that can be spent on consumables like laptops, books, and stationery. The objective of the KVPY Fellowship is to identify students with talent and aptitude for research, help them realize their academic potential, encourage them to take up research career in science, and ensure the growth of the best scientific minds for research and development in the country.
Welcome back after the break. Today, ICT is building the foundation for government of internet to make services easier.
In the future, forecasters may also depend more and more on ICT tools known as decision support software, where understanding the weather will be a collaboration between man and machine. This collaboration was most successful in 2014, when Cyclone Hudhud came calling along India's eastern coast.
As you know, cyclone is a high impact weather event. It needs continuous upgradation of the bulletins and informations and continuous watch. This system helps the forecasters to continuously monitor and develop the bulletins every 3 hours.
The software allowed for prediction that was remarkably close to the real trajectory of the cyclone, 5 days in advance. Once such forecasts are developed, they are sent out by any and every mean possible in the world of information technology. In the future, such technology will yield more accuracy, not just to predict ahead, but also to look back into the past. How? Join us after the break. 2015, the Science Express rolls into New Delhi. Aboard it is a glimpse of the future that takes us, like never before, into the past. On display is the virtually Vitala exhibit, a three-dimensional rendering of a place that no longer exists.
ये वर्चुअल रियलिटी टेक्निक है जिसके अंदर हम रियलिटी को वर्चुअली दिखा रहे हैं मतलब ये चीजें रियल में हैं लेकिन हम इनको वर्चुअली दिखा रहे हैं ये सच में यहां पे नहीं है
This exhibit is part of a massive Indian digital heritage project that aims to recreate the ruins of Hampi, Karnataka.
A user comes here and is handed a laser pointer and they want to know what this is all about. So all they can need to do is simply point it at one place and understand all the details about this structure.
The exhibit allows visitors to walk through as if they were actually in Hampi at the Vitala temple, in the thick of the Vijayanagara Empire that existed over 5 centuries ago.
It'll take you where you can't otherwise go, right? You can fly, it's like a little fly flying through space. And you want to stop and look around at some place, you can start to do that, right? I want to turn left instead of going that way, and I can start to see that.
Recreating this experience involved integrating ICT at many levels with historical and cultural research.
So we brought together techniques from computer vision to capture still images and videos and try to gather the 3D shape from it. We also use laser scanning to try to figure what it looked like, what the different dimensions ratios would have been and the like, and created by hand parts of the 3D model.
Today, it is the Hampi project. Tomorrow, virtually, any historical era or event may be recreated using technology. From rejuvenating the past to igniting the future, ICT is carving a new path, especially for the next generation, for whom exciting opportunities await. And not just at the back office of the world, but across new areas that conjoin traditional fields with cutting-edge information and communication technology. From bioinformatics to digital heritage, from online activists to open data change makers, from distance educators to doctors, bankers, and scientists of tomorrow. Thanks to ICT, not even the sky will be the limit.
Well, friends, that's all for today. We will be back with another episode of India at IT Revolution very soon. But please do not forget to send your views about the show.
You can mail us at ddscience@vigyanprasad.gov.in. You can write to us at Vigyan Prasad, A50, Institutional Area, Sector 62, Noida, UP 201309. For program schedule, please log on to www.vigyanprasad.gov.in.